Pastor Search Committee will meet on Tuesday, August 8th at 2:30 p.m. And our women's ministry will be holding a lay-making fellowship. I know I mentioned this before. It'll be on Tuesday, August 22nd, and it's beginning at 7 p.m. at the Balberde's house. And we have the address listed there. If you are interested in being shuttled there, if you can drive at night, we still want you to come because it's at 7 p.m. at night. So please, my number is on number 3 there, so you can give me a call or you can text me and just let me know you need a ride, how many people, and if you live close enough, I can pick you up from your house and drop you off. But if we have enough people, we'll have 2 cars or whatever number of cars. The main goal is we want you there to fellowship. And it's a simple tea leaf making that we're doing. Auntie Judy had opened up her house to have everyone there. We just like to fellowship our church a lot. So that is one reason. But more so, we want you to bring people bring your friends, maybe that don't come to church, and bring them as a time to fellowship, to meet other people in our church as well. And we'll just have a big blast. And we'll have poo-poos and stuff there for us to enjoy as we're making lanes, okay? So please join us if you can, bring friends, and let me know if you guys need a ride. Volunteers are needed to assist BCM as they prepare for the new school year. So their Globe Games event is on Wednesday the 23rd, which I believe is, yeah, on a Wednesday. So please let Wendy, and Wendy, can you raise your hand? So that's Wendy Okazaki. So you can let her know if you want to volunteer or provide ice cream toppings for that. Also, a dinner is scheduled for Thursday, September 7th. And Lynne, Higa, Auntie Lynne, there you are, right next to Wendy, is requesting assistance with food or money donations and serving. So please sign up on the sheet, which is in the back of our sanctuary. If you skip down to number 7, an anonymous donor has dropped off a large amount of face masks. So we want to thank you for that, for the donations. And some of them will be kept, but most of them will be given to other churches or organizations. If you need any masks, please pick up a box or two before you leave the church today. And we also have some mystery angels in our church. So I was told while I was gone, jealousies have been fixed in our church by Uncle Ed Higa. So we want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. As we were like unwinding jealousies, we're like, oh my gosh, they all work. So thank you, Uncle Higa, for that. And somebody anonymously put this black handle rail bar so that you can access the stage easier if you need assistance. So thank you for whoever blessed us with that as well, and the installment of it. Okay, I have one more announcement. And this one is actually a letter from the First Baptist Church of Sellersburg, which is in Indiana. And the letter reads, "Dear friends, First Baptist Church of Sellersburg is honored to be your prayer partner. We are praying Colossians 1, verses 9 and 10 for our Hawaii Pacific Baptist Convention partners. For this cause, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire that we might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord, unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God." And it says, "May God be glorified through your ministry." And the signatures below are representatives of the First Baptist family who are praying for you. And they have a whole bunch of people that have signed from their church, including a little boy named Caleb Mayer. And he wrote his name at the bottom here. So thank you, First Baptist Church. And they also included their bulletin, which I thought was really colorful. I was, oh, if anybody knows how to do this in our church, let us know. We would love to have somebody make our bulletins nice and colorful. But they have their Bible study listed here, the message. And then they had, as I was looking through this, they are praying for several churches in the Hawaii Pacific partners. So it says Valley Isle Fellowship, Pastor Nicholas Love, Waikea Baptist Bible Church needs pastor, Waialea Baptist Church, Pastor Matt Sanders, and Waianae Baptist Church, Pastor Mike Brooks. So I guess this came up in the conference, and so they're praying for these specific churches, which include us. And they also came to Mission Hamakua, which was a student's Hawaii mission trip. So it says students will be sharing August 6th at their evening service. So I guess they do a lot of work in the Pacific region. And so we praise God for this church and their prayers. So thank you. All right. So as we conclude, we also have other announcements that I did not go over, so please make sure that you take a look at that on your right side of your announcements here. And we also have Auntie Susie that has the Friday updates as well for our prayer requests. So if you would like information on that, that's also listed in here as well. All right, with that, we'll go. Oh, and Uncle also, and welcome back, Uncle Jim from Samoa.
Just a quick announcement that we have just beginning a study of the Book of John. And if you have interest in that, I'm going to be emailing out lessons for each week. And the dozen or so people that were there this morning gave me their email address. But if you're interested in participating in that class, we'd love to have you. I think you're going to find it to be a fascinating study with all the insights of all the people that are in that, and certainly the Word of God to hear the potential applications, to gain a better understanding of His instructions. We'll have a great time doing it. So praise God for the opportunity, and I look forward for you getting a hold of me and sharing with me how I might send you the lessons so that you can get involved in that class. Thank you.
Thanks, Michael. All right, and I don't see any new faces. I might be wrong, but Auntie Sarah, we're okay. So welcome back, everybody. Let's go to prayer. So if you can bow your heads. Our Heavenly Father, dear Lord, we thank you once again for this day, dear Lord. Thank you for a beautiful week. Lord, thank you for being with all of us. We just pray that as we open our service this morning, that you just be with one another, be with each other, dear Lord, that we just learn everything that you have to teach us this morning, dear Lord. We thank you for all that you do. We thank you for our speakers, Lord, for all those that make this happen, dear Lord. We thank you for the people that continually bless our church with their presence. Lord, we pray for those that are not here today, who could not make it due to illness or other reasons, that you continue to be with them. Lord, as we glorify your name today in worship, we just pray that you continue to be with us as one accord. Thank you for all that you continue to bless us with. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
So we're going to do a little more praying today. So we're going to take time. As you know, we're getting deep into our pastor search. And we passed out the 30-day prayer guide a few weeks ago. And if you haven't been able to follow, we'd like you to get started. You don't have to follow it exactly the way it is, but just be in prayer for our pastor search. So at this time, we're going to do a few prayers that's suggested from the prayer guide. So if you would please stand, we will start those of you who can. So on day 9 of the prayer guide, it suggests that we read from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 12. It also says the following: to pray with the understanding that searching for a pastor is primarily a spiritual process. Therefore, spiritual warfare will be present. So we are to pray for God's protection on the individual search committee members and their families in the church. So let's now read together Ephesians 6, chapter 10, verse 12, after which I will follow in the prayer. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Father God, it is you who makes us strong. We need your strength to fight against the powers that lure us away from you and toward the evil things of this world. We know that evil dwells in everything here on earth and is ready to strike, especially when we are being obedient to you. We are weak, so empower each of us, Lord, especially as we strive to find the man you intend to serve as our pastor for YK Baptist Bible Church. In Jesus' name we pray. We'll have two more, so please remain standing. Good morning. So the scripture we're going to read today is from Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. If we'll read it together.
My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts.
And so on that day, it says we should pray for God's clear direction on how applications and resumes are examined and interviews conducted. So ask God to bring the right person to the attention of the community. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you said to ask, and you will provide, and our joy will be complete. So we ask for wisdom and discernment as we seek a pastor for our church. We know you have already decided who should be our pastor, but we must be obedient to your will and not our own. So we ask that you remove our own biases and values and replace them with complete faith and trust in the higher plans that you have for us. Please guide us, our steps, and light our path, so that in all of this, you will be glorified. And this is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And our final one for day 23, which will be tomorrow's prayer guide, says that we should pray for strong consistency and focus in the present ministry of the church. So let's read together Revelation 3:15 before I pray.
I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other.
Dear Lord, thank you for providing our pulpit with godly speakers and men who love and strive to obey you. Thank you for the leadership you have granted in the past 12 to 13 months, who have kept your house in order and are striving to make it grow strong in all the ways that will be pleasing to you. Please continue to grant great power to our leadership in following your will. Please continue to provide speakers of your word who will strengthen our desire to follow you. Make it clear to each of us that you are carefully directing us to do your will, if only we would be obedient to your instructions. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody says,
Amen.
All right. Thank you so much. So now we'll begin our praise songs. For those of you that are tired of standing, you are welcome to sit if you want to, and we can still praise the Lord sitting, standing. But please join us in our first song, which is Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Redeemer and friend, who would have thought
I know.
Corari.
To the words that have been said. We ask it through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. First off, I gotta say, I cannot take credit for this message. This message was actually written by Billy Graham back in September 13, 2010. I have added some of my input into it, but majority of it is from Billy Graham. But I think it is something that we can apply to us in our lives today. It's also something that I use way back in the men's ministry when we met at the bakery on Kauai Street. I forget the name. But anyway, I hope that it makes sense to you guys. Okay, the title is, Are You a Carnal Christian? Okay. Does that describe you? And if so, would you like to change? Now, according to Merriam-Webster Dictionary, among other definitions, carnal also means temporal or worldly, although related to human world and ordinary life, rather than the religious or spiritual matters. So that's what we'd be looking at when we hear the word carnal, about the worldly and not spiritual matters. There was a time, perhaps, when you were a spiritual Christian. You still had your first love. A fire burned in your heart for God. But something has happened along the way. Something has disturbed your relationship with God, and you no longer know the joy, the peace, and the thrill that you once knew. You don't take time to read your Bible. Your prayer times are few. Your interest in spiritual things has waned, and yet there's a great hungering after God, an aching in your soul for the joy and victory that you have seen in the lives of others. You want that joy in your soul, that thrill in your heart. You want to know the power of prayer again. The Bible teaches that you can have glorious daily victory. Scripture says, for sin shall not be your master, because you are not under law, but under grace, from Romans 6:14. Sin is no longer the believer's ruler. Sin gained its power by using the law, but the Christian is under the rule of grace rather than the law. Paul wrote in Romans 7:24, what wretched man I am. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body of death? And then he answers his own question in the next verse, 7:25. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. In verse 24, Paul is figuratively using the term body of death as a body of sin that hung on him like a corpse and from which he could not gain freedom. In verse 25, Paul states that deliverance comes not through legalistic effort, but through Christ Jesus. In Romans 8:2, we read, because through Jesus Christ, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. The believer's freedom comes from Jesus' resurrection and his works as a sin offering and by the Holy Spirit's operation in providing eternal life. Jesus took on humanity. He did not cease to be God, but took on a real human nature without sin and became the perfect offering. He fulfilled the law's demands in his life and in his death and broke sin's power in a human body on the cross. In 1 Corinthians 15:57, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ brings not only victory over death in the resurrection, but also victory over sin that leads to death. From the divine viewpoint, defeated Christians are abnormal. They are paralyzed members of the body of Christ. Backsliding and carnality are not only inexcusable, They are incompatible with the normal Christian experience. They produce a regime of contradiction. Since the living Christ dwells within every one of us who has accepted him as Savior, there is never any reason for defeat. No enemy is too powerful for Christ. Every temptation may be resisted. If you as a Christian are overcome by the enemy, the simple explanation is that Christ has been denied his rightful position of supremacy in your heart. The dethronement of Christ will always lead to failure in spiritual warfare. It is Christ and Christ alone who can give you a constant, daily, victorious life. We need to know our three enemies. The Bible teaches that every Christian has three enemies. The first enemy that we have to contend with is the world. Now the world means the present evil world, the great system of evil around about us. It is everything around us that has a tendency to lead us into sin. It may mean the evil people of the world, or it may mean the things of the world. Certain elements of life are not sinful in themselves, but they can lead to sin if they are abused. Abuse literally means extreme use, and in many instances, overuse of lawful things becomes sin. Thinking about the necessities of life and taking care of one's family is essential, but this can degenerate into anxiety, and then, as Christ reminded us, the cares of this life choke the spiritual seed of the heart. Mark 4:19 says, "But the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desire for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful." Making money is necessary for daily living, but money making is apt to degenerate into money loving, and then the deceitfulness of riches enters and spoils our spiritual life. Prosperity tends to give a false sense of self-sufficiency, security, and well-being. The Bible admonishes, "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." In 1 John 2:15. Things of the world are not just material things. They are the things that absorb human love for the Father. It is not the world of people or the created world, but the world of or realm of sin, which is controlled by Satan and organized against God and righteousness. The second enemy of the Christian is the flesh. Paul said in Romans 7:18, "I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out." The Bible teaches that the flesh is fallen human nature. It is the corrupt principle of sin, the carnal nature the natural men and women have inherited from their fallen parents. And I take this to mean Adam and Eve. It is the birthplaces of all those ugly sins that so easily mar the Christian's joy and end his or her testimony. The sins of temper, irritability, moodiness, jealousy, pride, selfishness, an unforgiving spirit, anxiety or fretfulness, harshness, complaining, criticism, lust, all of these things characterize the flesh. The third enemy of the Christian is the devil, referred to by Paul as the prince of the power of the air in Ephesians 2:2. The Bible teaches that the devil is a real person. His objective is to defeat the will of God in the world, the church, and the Christian. He is the unceasing enemy of the soul. He must be met and overcome. Thank God to the victory of Christ Jesus on the cross. This mighty enemy has been fully and finally vanquished. One day the whole world will see the full consummation of Christ's triumph. Meanwhile, Satan is busy in the world, sometimes appearing as an angel of the light, and other times as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. These then are our three foes: the world, the flesh, and the devil. The attitude of the Christian to all three is summed up in one word: renounce. There must be no bargaining, no compromise, no hesitation. Absolute renunciation is the only possible way for the Christian to have victory in life. If you are a Christian, There is no excuse for not having daily victory in your life by renouncing sin and by faith, then in the Spirit of God, have control of your life. Closing prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We ask that you give us the strength and the power and the knowledge to avoid and to know who our enemies are, and that we may come to you and live our lives as you want us, so that we may have eternal life with you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Are you happy? In American Samoa, when you go, it's one of the interesting little things that you see as you drive around are the license plates. They look like any license plate, except they have a little phrase on the top. Motu o Piapiana means island of happiness. And you see happiness, you see happy people. And that hasn't changed much. I was last there about 20 years ago. And the island is still filled with many happy people. And I always, even though I've lived there for 2 years in the late 1970, and have been back several times on different consulting projects, it always, you're amazed at that license plate, Motu Ophia Fianga. And then at the same time, you see that there is such a reverence for Jesus Christ everywhere. I mean, even signs that are along the road that may talk about God. In the back of buses, Jesus is the door. Oh yes, it's right on the back of the bus. They've got signs everywhere. They have smiling faces, and they are there. There's Faifeawa, who is the minister of the local church in their villages, and they give guidance during the week to the residents of their village. People are active in their churches, as they are here. But there is a, you can see how God changes people. And that was such a refreshing thing to see. Even though there's all those changes that I hoped I wouldn't see, all the cell phones and all the people doing that and making some changes in their culture, which I see, which have gotten away from a more traditional culture that I saw 50 years ago. In that country, things are there. But today, are you happy? Are you happy? With everything that's going on in your life, are you happy?
Yes.
If you are, praise God. Because that means you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's hard to be happy unless you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I was thinking about that during Larry's wonderful message this morning, is that if you're stuck with wanting to have everything, you just can't have enough, can you? If you're looking for money and return on investment and that's what you're living for, you just can't get enough. But if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you have enough. That's all you need, is a relationship with Jesus. This morning, if you're here and you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, man, I know that road. I know it firsthand. I know it real well. And I know how empty that can be. And I know how fulfilling it can be by having a relationship with Jesus. Even when there's challenges that you go through that are over your head, and you don't know what to do or where to turn next, and you have a peace because you know that Jesus is in your heart and that he changes people. And I invite you this morning, if you would like to have us pray for you, the deacons are here. We'd love to pray for you to to come into your life and change your life in a mighty way. And perhaps you're saying, well, no, Jim, I believe in Jesus, but maybe my life, I've just kind of drifted away for a while, and I need to be a jump start on my relationship with Jesus Christ. I invite you to come forward too, so that we can all pray for you. So as we sing the next song, one of the most beautiful hymns, what a friend we have in Jesus. Come forward if that's your heart today.
Please rise.
Someone here, the Lord, that does not have a relationship with it all, and it's kind of unnerving to come up and stand up before a bunch of people and say that that's where I am. But if that's where you are this morning, we pray, Lord, that you would say this prayer, and let's all join in this prayer to be supportive of any person that might be in that situation. Heavenly Father, we know that you died on the cross for our sins.
We know that you died on the cross for our sins.
We pray that we know that you change people.
know that you change people.
And I need change.
And I need change.
And I pray, Lord, that you would be the leader of my life.
And I pray, Lord, that you would be the leader of my life.
That I would turn to you.
That
I'd be faithful to you.
And I'd be faithful to you.
And I pray all these things in the name of Jesus.
And I pray all these things in the name of Jesus.
Thank you. That he has brought forth, dear Lord. And as we face this coming week, dear Lord, that you will be in every step that we take, dear Lord, in every thought that we think, dear Lord, in everything that we do, that everything we do is for your purpose and your purpose alone. So, Lord, we praise you throughout this week, this day, until we see each other again. Give each and every one of us here travel mercies. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Have a good day, you guys.